so, would you take a position in the Trump administration?
So, look, I mean, I think he's got a lot of great people to choose from. I think he's, you know, he's been around the track once. I think he's thought a lot about, you know, how to approach it this time. I think he'll end up hopefully with a lot of really great people. I mean, I think for me, I'm not seeking anything. I've got a great job in the state of Florida. And the way I view it is, you know, I do this because I want to make an impact. I want to make a difference. If I see something that needs corrected, I want to have the ability to go in and do it. And we've done that. And so how can I best make a difference? I think, you know, given where we are, I think me quarterbacking the Sunshine State is probably how I make the biggest difference. And, you know, we've got, you know, I've got my six-year-old here, first grader, Mason, and he's a... His sisters didn't want to come on the trip. They said it was too cold to come to Indiana in November. But, you know, he's a diehard Florida State fan, and he needs a few more football seasons under his belt. 90%, yes, but they're still counting votes in California. I mean, who knows what's going to happen in the next 2 weeks? I mean, it's a rotten system. So you will have, most likely, somewhere, you know, 218's the majority. You'll probably have 220, 221 Republicans. I think it's going to be really, really difficult. I mean, I think that's a high wire act. The prospects of there being meaningful budget reform, let's just put it this way, if you're betting on that, I would take the under on the prospects on that. I mean, I think there'll be a lot of good things that are that'll be done with executive orders, with President Trump. I think there may be some things they can get through the Congress. But spending reduction, I don't know. Look, Elon Musk says he's going to cut all this out, and I think he's a smart guy, and hopefully they do restrain spending, because ultimately, if you want to stop having an inflationary economy, you can't spend so much, right? So we'll see what happens, but my sense is that the majority is so thin that the Democrats are just going to say no to everything, I think. They're just going to hunker down. And I think it's going to be very difficult to get anything done.
Okay. We have about 15 minutes left. The questions are pouring in, so we're going to try to go as fast as we can here. I have two questions from different students, but they're questions that ask you to talk to students directly. The first is from one of our fellows, Michael Kennedy. He says, today there's a student protest going on right now, and he's quoting from them. They say you're anti-democracy, anti-LGBTQ, restrictive of voting rights and immigration, anti-Palestine. How would you respond to those students out there protesting? And then let me get a second question in for a different student who writes, and I'm paraphrasing here since it's not in front of me. Some of my conservative friends were not sure they should come to this lecture because they're afraid of being viewed as conservative on campus. What would you say to them?
Great question. So on the protesters, you know, honestly what I would tell them is get some new material. Those are... I mean, these are just left-wing cliches, like anti-democracy. I mean, what does that even mean? You know, so it's just ridiculous. But let's just take, because, you know, we had the big October 7th incidents on campuses at, like, Columbia and all those other things. And, you know, people sometimes ask me, well, why did that not happen in Florida? And I said, well, it didn't happen in Florida because if any of our universities turned into Columbia, the university president would lose their job the next day. It would be done. We would not ever tolerate the inmates running the asylum. But one of the things that irks me about that is it's not just, yes, this is bad behavior. It's totally fine for them what they're doing, you know, targeting Jewish students. But the cliches that they use betray their ignorance. So, for example, if you're saying end the occupation, well, Gaza is not occupied by Israel. Israel pulled out of there in 2006. So Gaza, the people in Gaza, the Arabs down there, they had free reign to try to make something of that area. And it's beautiful coastline right on the Mediterranean Sea. What decision did they make? Did they try to make a good life for their constituents? No, they elected Hamas to run the Gaza Strip. Why? Because they wanted Hamas to launch attacks against Israel. You hear about occupation generally There has never been a Palestinian Arab state. In fact, you go back, just look at the history. First of all, open up a Bible, thousands and thousands of years of connection between the Jewish people and the land of Israel. And if you've been there, you can walk it and you can see it. It's there. I've done it. And then what happened more recently? Well, after World War I, you had a British mandate. British mandate for Palestine. Before that, for hundreds of years, it was controlled by Turks, the Ottoman Empire. No Palestinian Arab state existed there. So then what happens at the end of the British mandate? They say, okay, let's do a Jewish state and an Arab state. And so that was the UN partition plan. Israel, and it was a squiggly little Israel. I mean, it was not a very generous partition for them, but they accepted it and they declared independence. Did the Palestinian Arabs accept the Arab state that they were given? No. They went to war to try to annihilate the Jewish state. They lost. Then they tried to launch an attack that Israel preempted in 1967 in the Six-Day War, and they lost. Then they launched an attack in 1973 in the Yom Kippur War, and they lost. Then they've done a series of intifadas year after year in the 80s and 90s. They had this Oslo Accords, and that has been a total failure. And then now you have more recently Hamas butchering people. I mean, putting elderly people in ovens, raping women, beheading children. That's what they were doing. So there was never been a Palestinian Arab state. They've rejected a state time and time again. They've lost wars as a result of it. And, you know, my view is like, okay, well, why do they get all these mulligans? How come they never have to accept any type of compromise? And the reason is they are taught from a very young age, not that they want to be an independent state. Their goal is to eliminate the Jewish state. That is what they're trying to do. And so if you find yourself out there saying somehow end occupation, you know, I would just like to know, you know, when there was some type of Palestinian. So I think it's all people that don't know their history. I think it's kind of like the left-wing cause du jour, so they do it. And I'm sorry, this is with the election. There's a little bit of poetic justice. So Biden and Harris, by definition, they got so skittish on supporting Israel because you had an uprising and a revolt in Michigan amongst a lot of the Muslim American voters. And so they were trying to kind of pacify and telling Israel, end it, you gotta stop, and not giving Israel the full support that I think they deserved. And so Harris is running as more dovish on that, doesn't like Netanyahu, all this other stuff. Then you got Trump, who, you know, wanted the so-called Muslim ban when he was president and said basically Israel needs to just finish the job. And he beat her with the same Muslim voters in Michigan. I mean, so they totally screwed. So I think that all this stuff is just typical cliche, but that's why I think having something like this is important, because a lot of these college campuses, those types of students are never challenged on their assumptions.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Don't forget to like our videos and hit the bell icon to stay updated with the latest.